here. Let me see. I am recording, I hope. Okay. So, to the folks who are out there and can hear us already, welcome to the One World Mind Seminar, Mathematics of Information, Data, and Signals. Our speaker today is Dr. Razenshteyn, who received his PhD in 2017 from the MIT Computer Science and AI Laboratory, where his thesis was awarded two Best Thesis Awards, both the George M. Sproules Award for Best Thesis of that year in Computer Science, as well as the EATCS Distinguished Dissertation Award the next year. After finishing at MIT, he then moved to become a Simons Junior Fellow at Columbia University. And after finishing there, he moved on to become a senior researcher in the Machine Learning and Optimization Group at Microsoft Research in Redmond, where he is currently residing and presumably talking to us from. So I'm really happy to have Ilya here to tell us what he's been working on. And so I'll turn the floor over to him.
Thanks, Mark, for the introduction. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, perfect. So I'll talk about optimal transport and how to do nearest neighbor search with respect to optimal transport distances. This is based on a paper which you can find on archive. It's joint work with Arthur Zbachkurs from TTIC, Yihe Dong, who is at Microsoft, Piotr Indik, who is my former PhD advisor, he is at MIT, and Tal Wagner, who is at MIT, and he's incoming postdoc at our group. All right, let me start with the optimal transport part of the title, and then we will get to nearest neighbors eventually. So the starting point for optimal transport is the following intuition. As we know, there are many ways to compute distance between points or vectors in like 2, 3 or high dimensions. But what if you have two sets of points? How do you compute distance between the sets? And there are obviously many ways to do it depending on the application, but one standard way that is adequate for many applications is the minimum cost matching. So what is the minimum cost matching? So suppose you have two sets of points, red and blue, and suppose that they have the same cardinality for starters, then minimum cost matching is seeking to map red points into blue points in a one-to-one way, so to minimize sum of distances. And important thing here is that there is some implicit underlying metric, not implicit, there is underlying metric. In case of this picture, this is just two-dimensional Euclidean distance. And this induces a metric on sets of n points, right? It's pretty clear that this is a reasonable measure, and we will see some applications where it prominently shows up. Let me just for now raise a question of how to compute it quickly. I'm sure many of you know the answer, that there are indeed fast algorithms for computing such a matching. But if you haven't seen anything like this, then it might sound like a tricky problem, and in some sense it is tricky, because here you are supposed to optimize over set of all permutations, right? So naively, you would need to compute to enumerate all possible permutations between n points, and there are like n factorial of them. But in fact, there are much faster algorithms for computing such a minimum cost matching, and we will see them later. Okay, and now let me slightly generalize and relax the problem a little bit to make it on one hand easier, and on the other hand more useful. So this setup is called Wasserstein distances. It's also called optimal transport. It's also called Earth-Moore distances for certain regimes. Basically, there are many names depending on which branch of science or mathematics you are coming from. But let me explain what's going on. So this is a generalization of a minimum cost matching. And now this generalization is in some sense twofold. First of all, we don't require our sets of points to have equal size. And moreover, we don't require, in some sense before, we put equal weight on each of the points, right? So we said that blue points, each of them costs one, and red points, also each of them costs one. But now we basically have some distribution over red points. And distribution over blue points. So on this picture, I don't know if you can see it well, but some of the points are brighter than others. So this means that mass in them is higher. So basically, like, brighter points are more prominent. Points that are dimmer are, like, less prominent. And of course, now it doesn't make sense to ask for, like, minimum cost matching. What is the matching now, given that the number of points is different and not all of them are created equal? But now, this is exactly the optimal transport problem. So what are we trying to optimize here? So as before, we have some metric space. In this case, this is again just two-dimensional Euclidean space. And we have two distributions on it, mu1 and mu2. So in general, we don't require them to be finitely supported or anything like this. But for the sake of this talk, given that we talk about algorithms, let's assume that mu1 and mu2 are supported on a finite set of points and, like, sufficiently small. So what we are looking for a measure for a distribution over metric space product itself, such that, first of all, marginals of this distribution are exactly our distributions, mu1 and mu2. And second, we are trying to minimize this functional. So basically, we are trying to minimize expectation over this distribution that we are trying to find, pth power of the distance in our metric. So basically, minimum cost matching corresponded to p equals 1. Where we minimized sums of distances. And for this setting, we can also it's a perfectly reasonable thing to ask for p equals 1. But in general, people consider p also larger than 1. And this is called, it's not hard to check that this is a metric. And this is called Wasserstein p distance between distributions over a metric space. So for this talk, I will mostly focus on the case p equals 1. So basically, we are trying to minimize average distance between endpoints. And this is called Earth-Moore's distance. So basically, it's a particular case. And this case is much nicer mathematically and algorithmically. So mathematically, one reason why it's nicer, because in that case, not only it's a metric, it also happens to be representable as a norm. And moreover, this is not just some norm. It's a norm that is dual to the space of all Lipschitz functions on your metric space. So basically, if you take metric space and consider all Lipschitz functions into reals or complex numbers or whatever, you define the norm as like Lipschitz constant, then dual space to this is exactly Wasserstein 1 space over measures defined on your space. But anyways, it's not going to be important for us. And also, I should say that this fact and many more facts and many applications in mathematics of Wasserstein distances can be found in books of Cedric Villani. One of them is called Optimal Transport. It's a really great book. There are also others. Basically, Wasserstein distances are used like a lot. But in this talk, I will mostly focus on more computer science and algorithmic applications of them. One hint why this relaxation of a problem is a little bit nicer than before is because now you may get some feel, and it would be a correct intuition, that the problem became more continuous, and maybe it's more amenable to some algorithmic techniques that we all know and love, and we will see in a couple of slides that this is indeed the case. But before I'll start talking about algorithms, let me tell you some applications to, let me talk a little bit about some applications to computer science. So traditionally, Earth-Moore distance appeared in this paper. Actually, it was considered before, but this paper is considered a very prominent reference by Rubner, Tomasi, and Guibas from 2000. Basically, they started using Earth-Moore distance to compute similarity between images. So what specifically they looked on? They looked on several things, but one of the things was, if you want to consider how similar two images are in terms of colors, then one thing to do is to take both of these images. So like, let's focus on one image, take pixels one by one and put them in the color space. So what is a color space? It's a three-dimensional space, basically red, green, blue, right? So then each image becomes cloud of points in this color space. And then they argued and showed through some experiments that Earth-Moore distance between two clouds, it's a good measure of colored similarity. Here, like, I should focus your attention on the fact that this example is inherently low dimensional, right? So basically, our measures live in a three-dimensional Euclidean or L1 or whatever other metric you may consider, their space. Historically, I would say that such low-dimensional applications, low-dimensional examples of Earth-Moore distance were exactly used in the applications. And things changed a little bit when in 2015, this other paper appeared by Kusner's son, Kolkin, and Weinberger, where they showed how to use very nicely Earth-Moore distance between text documents. So what exactly they were proposing? Let's see. So basically, the starting point is the classic bag of words representation of your sentence or text. So suppose, basically, say you have two sentences and you want to understand how similar they are, right? So the classic algorithm that goes back to 50s or 60s or something like this says, okay, let's just create a vector for each word. We just count how many times it appears in this text, and this will be our vector. And then similarity between texts can be captured by dot product between these vectors or Euclidean distance between these vectors or something of this sort. But then, of course, the problem is what if your sentences have no common words, right? So, for example, these are the two sentences that you might want to compare. By the way, this picture is taken from this paper of Kusner et al. So how do you do this, right? Because words have no, except stop words, which we throw away anyways, these sentences have no intersection. So then what Kusner, San, Kolkin, and Weinberger suggested, let's just use word embeddings. So what are word embeddings? Word embeddings are basically, for each word, we compute a certain vector in a relatively high dimensional space. It could be 100 dimensional or 200 dimensional, something like this. So here, pictorially, we of course drew everything on the plane, but this is just for the illustration purposes. Nicely enough, it turns out that you can compute such vectors such that if your words are semantically similar, then your vectors will be close and vice versa. Basically, this paper proposed very naturally consider Earth mover distance between uniform distributions over respective word embeddings. So for example, if we have Obama speaks media Illinois, then it would be uniform distribution over these four blue points. And the sentence on the right would be uniform distribution over four black points. And then basically they evaluated the measure between documents, which is just Earth mover distance between these distributions. And what they found is that for many classification tasks, just running simple k nearest neighbor classifier with respect to this distance turns out to give very good results, much better than prior work. This is a really great discovery. And I should say that unlike the example I gave before with images, this is a high dimensional case. And in a certain way, this makes the problem more interesting that maybe we'll see later. And in general, I should say that unifying theme between these two examples, and in both examples, the reason why Earth-Moore distance gives good results is because before people were trying to just capture hard matches, right? So in case of images, in case of text, I guess it's especially easy to see. We just look at exactly same words, right? But Earth-Moore distance gives you a nice graceful degradation, right? So you might want to take into account things that are not exactly the same, but approximately the same. And that's why it is a good measure of similarity, and experiments just confirm that. So if you would like to run something like this, so basically image or text retrieval, or basically any other large scale computation with Earth mover distances, of course, we have a natural bottleneck. For example, if we want to run k-nearest neighbor classifier, so then we need to solve k-nearest neighbor problem with respect to Earth mover distance, right? So basically here, I'll repeat the problem again, mostly to fix the notation. So we have now, instead of one distribution, we have n distributions, again, finitely supported and otherwise nice, over d-dimensional space. And we call these distributions dataset. It might be a bit confusing, but bear with me. And then we have some query distribution that originates from some query text document or image or something of this sort. And then what we would like to find k closest dataset distributions with respect to Earth mover distance. So again, I should emphasize that there are two metrics here. There is underlying metric, which is used to define Earth mover distance. And there is Earth mover distance itself, which is also a metric. So there are two metric spaces. One is easy and one is more complicated. Easy metric is underlying metric. More complicated is this EMZ space. Okay. So basically, this is the problem. And traditionally, it's known as k-nearest neighbor search problem, KNNS. And there are tons of works, maybe like thousands of papers that study this problem for various distances. But I would say that most of the work was focused on Euclidean distance and maybe Hamming distance. Basically, very classic, very particular kinds of distances. And there, the problem is very well understood. And for other distances, it is definitely way trickier. For example, for EMD distance, which we will be discussing in this talk, but also there are some other examples which would be very nice to solve, such as edit distance, also known as Levenshteyn distance, and some other examples. So, and also I should emphasize that this is not just we took some problem, we took two problems and, you know, put them together and said, okay, here's a problem we want to solve. But basically our starting point was precisely this paper by Kusner et al, where they showed that, you know, actually k-nearest neighbor classifiers work well. So this poses this computational problem very naturally. Okay, so how can we solve something like this? So let's start with like something as naive as it gets, right? Suppose we don't care about running time, we just want to do something like this, right? So what would we do? The naive thing we can do is just, you know, if we have a query, let's compute n distances and choose k smallest ones. But how can we even compute distances, right? So we started with this like matching example and then we relaxed it, but then in the end of the day, how do we find these matchings, right? So unlike say the case where the distance is Euclidean, just computing EMD is already like a very interesting problem, and basically it's still not closed, right? So it's not a done deal on like Euclidean distance. So how can we do something like this? So just a reminder, what we're even trying to do here. So we have some metric space. For example, even on the plane, the problem is very meaningful and interesting. And then we have distribution over red points and distribution over blue points, right? And we would like to move red points into blue points by paying as little as possible in the distance, right? So basically try to come up with transportation plan, something like I drew here. And again, we might, so for example, if we have a single point, like blue point, we may want to move it into like two red points. This is perfectly fine. So it doesn't have to be one-to-one. And in fact, it cannot be, right? If you have different sizes, but this is fine. So this is called like fractional assignment or fractional matching. A fractional flow. So basically, for those of you who know what linear programming is, I assume like almost all of you know, this pretty much can be trivially formulated as a linear program, right? So we have for each pair of red-blue points, we have a variable, how much we move in this pair. And then we have marginal constraints. So basically each like red point should be moved exactly the right amount. Each blue point should be moved exactly right amount, and then we minimize some cost, right? So this is a trivially a linear program. Then, of course, you can feed it into your favorite linear program solver, which will solve it. So in some sense, if you only care about, you know, like I want to solve problems in polynomial time, this is the end of the story. Like you can stop watching this talk and be happy about it. But of course, this is slow, right? So if you have, for example, if we look at applications with images or texts, and we have, I don't know, even thousands of images or tens of thousands of images, and that's like very modest data set, it's like considered small by modern standards, such approach would not scale. What scales somewhat better, and we will see this actually being run in the end of the talk, is instead of generic linear program solver, use basically better algorithms for these specific kinds of linear programs. So basically it turns out that such problems fall under the category of something that is called minimum cost flows. So basically the idea is we have some graph and we have some capacities and we have some costs and we are trying to route some units of flow from like one point to another while trying to minimize the cost. So it's pretty trivial to see that this earth mover distance problem can be recast as such minimum cost flow problem. And there is a whole body of literature. There is no way I can cite even like a tiny fraction of it here comprehensively that just like comes up with better algorithms than running generic LP solver to solve this mean cost flow. And one algorithm that works particularly well, and we actually used it in our experiments later, I will talk more about it, is this algorithm of network simplex. It's kind of like simplex method for linear programming, but specified for this mean cost flow setting, and as a result, simplified and sped up. So basically, this network simplex is a way to go for such mean cost flow problems. And here I should also make an emphasis that in general, there are lots of papers appearing these days that talk about Wasserstein distance as optimal transport or Earth mover distance. And basically they say, okay, we can always write a linear program, but this is slow. So let's instead use some other algorithm that the paper presents. But very few papers, like actually I haven't seen there are virtually no papers that comprehensively compare what they propose with this combinatorial mean cost flow algorithms. And I do find it like a very important omission, and I invite if any of you are gonna write optimal transport paper with like better algorithm for optimal transport, please do compare it with combinatorial flow algorithms. Okay? Okay, so basically when it comes to computing distances exactly, this is more or less it, right? So we can either write our problem as a linear program or basically use some combinatorial algorithm. But of course, even using combinatorial algorithm turns out to be pretty slow. We will see later that it like scales-ish kind of, but not so well. So we really want to do something faster. So what can we do faster? So what you want, like what you can do faster really depends on the setting that you are in. So I presented you the definition of the Wasserstein distance as, you know, transportation between measures on some metric space. But in fact, if you think about it, there is no reason why cost matrix should be coming from a metric, right? So in principle, we can consider more general non-metric case, right? When we just have some like distributions over n objects, and then we have distribution over m object, and then we have n by m matrix of costs, right? How much does it cost to move from I to j? So this is called non-metric case, and it's a little bit more general. And then there are some approximations that work well for this non-metric case. So the first algorithm I would like to mention is this really nice algorithm by Kuturi from 2013. It basically does what is called synchorn iteration. I'm just thinking to what extent I should explain it to you, but okay, so let me be relatively brief here maybe for now. Maybe in the end of the talk I can give you more details. But basically the idea is the following. So we have this optimal transport problem, and then through some, so first of all, first step is to consider something that is called an entropic regularization of it. Basically, we also penalize our distribution for having too high entropy. We wanted to have relatively low entropy. Then after we regularized our problem, we basically reduce this regularized problem to something that is called matrix scaling. So matrix scaling is the following question. We have matrix with positive numbers and we want to make it doubly stochastic. So each row should sum to one, each column should sum to one, right? And we want to multiply each row and each column by some number such that this happens. And this is actually a pretty tricky problem. And way that some people are solving it is by doing this alternating minimization. So basically like say, okay, we need to satisfy something for rows and for columns. This is tricky to do at the same time. But at least if you just focus on rows, this is trivial, which we can just normalize each row, right? And for columns, we can also do this. We can just like normalize each column and be happy. And we keep repeating it until we converge. So this is called synchorn iterations because it appeared in an old paper of Synchorn. But Kuturi used it for optimal transport through this entropic regularization, and it works very well. It's a very simple to implement algorithm, and it converges fairly quickly. And then, of course, what you can always do, you can do all kinds of greedy algorithm, right? Of course, I'm here showing only references from 2015 and 2019, but of course, this is unreasonable to think that this is exactly when greedy algorithms for optimal transport were invented. Of course, they were invented probably before the problem was invented, but I'm citing these papers because they used greedy algorithms for basically for this classification kind of tasks that we are looking at. And you can like, okay, simplest greedy algorithm you can consider is the following. Let's just assign each point, each red point to the closest blue point. Of course, it wouldn't be a matching, but it's a lower bound for the cost of matching, right? And we can do the same from like red side. So basically assign each red point to the closest blue point. This would also be a lower bound, and we can choose maximum of these two lower bounds. And that would be the lower bound of our true EMD cost between two sets. And then this, so actually this greedy was exactly used in this paper by Kusner, Sun, Kolkin, and Weinberger. And then in this follow-up paper, they somewhat refined it, and it became a little bit better in some cases. Okay, so that's pretty much it for the non-metric case. And then, but then there is further progress possible for metric case. So now suppose that actually we know for a fact that our cost matrix is not general, but comes from some underlying metric space, like basically like examples I showed you in the beginning, right? So here the hope is not only to obtain something reasonably fast, but here the hope is not even to write the cost matrix, right? So suppose that we have n red points and n blue points, right? So then the full cost matrix would be of size n by n, and computing it takes time at least n by n, right? Just to write it down. And this is something we would like to avoid. So basically we want to be like subquadratic in the number of points ideally, maybe even linear or near linear in the number of points. So this is the regime that I'm gonna focus on for now. Many of the algorithms proceed by saying, okay, we have this like complicated Earth Moore distance space, right? Or Wasserstein 1 space, whatever you want to call it. This is pretty hard to work with space. Maybe we can simplify it a little bit by, for instance, embedding this EMD space into some nicer space that we can easier, that we can deal with somewhat easier. For example, Euclidean distance or L1 distance or something like this. So for example, in the Kusner et al. Paper, what they consider as a cheap approximation, cheap but admittedly pretty crude approximation of the Earth-Moore distance, they consider just distance between means of distributions. If I have two distributions, I can collapse each of them into a mean and just consider Euclidean distance between them as a lower bound for EMD. And this is a valid lower bound. It's very cheap to compute, very fast. But of course, you can imagine that it can be of pretty poor quality. Like you can easily come up with two distributions that have the same mean, but pretty large EMD distance between them, right? So they just use it as a like reasonable heuristic. At the same time, if you want like to obtain some embedding into some nice space rigorously, for example, there is this old classic paper of Indic and Tupper from 2003, where they consider an algorithm which is called QuadTree. And given that in this paper we come up with certain improvement of QuadTree, I'm going to focus on this QuadTree thing for a while now. So what's the underlying philosophy here? So the philosophy is very simple. So we have some underlying metric space M upon which we design our EMD metric. So for example, in the beginning, I showed you two-dimensional Euclidean distance, and that's a very valid example. Underlying metric could be just that. So then the idea of QuadTree is to approximate this underlying metric with a tree metric. So what is a tree metric? Tree metric is just a tree with some edge weights. And naturally, it induces shortest path metric on its vertices, right? So for example, here we have weights 5, 3, 1, 6, then the distance between like, do you see my mouse, by the way, or not? Can I use this mouse as a pointer?
Yeah, I can see it.
Okay, perfect. So for example, distance between this point and this point would be just like 9, because it's 5 plus 3 plus 1, right? And this idea of approximation general metrics with tree metrics, it's very natural because trees in general are way nicer than general metrics, and trees are much nicer for the algorithms. How to do this? That's of course a very non-trivial and deep question, which we will talk about a little bit on the next slide. But for now, suppose we somehow managed to do it, right? So then what can we do further? So then we consider Earth-Moore distance over our original metric M. And then because, you know, our tree metric is a reasonable approximation of our metric M, then it's natural to expect that EMD over the tree is a reasonable approximation of EMD over M, right? But then the next observation is that EMD over the tree, actually it's a very simple metric. It can be realized as a distance between vectors, just our normal L1 distance. So we will see why this is so, by the way, in a couple of slides. And by the way, there is a slight fine print here. So this is true not for general trees, but for certain kinds of trees, which we will be getting. But morally, this is true. I'm lying a little bit, but just to gloss over some details, which we will see later. And okay, because EMD over the tree is a embeddable Intel one, then naturally we obtain a good embedding of EMD over our original metric Intel one, and that's exactly what we wanted. And this is exactly how QuadTree proceeds, but QuadTree is a little bit more specialized algorithm than what I've been describing you here. So let me talk a little bit, just for a few minutes, about tree approximations of general metrics. And why this is good for algorithms, I forgot to tell you, is because, you know, computing L1 distance is much faster than computing than Earth-mover distance. You don't need to solve any linear programs. You don't need to run any combinatorial flow algorithms. You just pre-compute for each measure certain vector, and then you just compute L1 distance between these vectors. So this is super fast. So basically, it's a nice result from structural point of view, because it's just nice to know that some complicated space embeds into some nice space. But at the same time, this also gives a very concrete, very simple to see algorithmic improvement, because computing L1 distances, it's much faster than running flows on graphs or running in LP programs or running like synchron iterations for that matter, anything. So this is why it's useful. Okay, our result, as I said, it's an improvement upon QuadTree, but it's improvement in certain way, but it's a degradation in some other way. So basically it's improvement because it's higher accuracy, but it's a degradation because it's not embedding into L1 anymore. And again, we will see why. So I'm just like here, it will take us a while to build to this flow tree, but I'm just giving you a little bit of context here so that you know what to anticipate. Okay, so let's talk for one slide about tree approximations. I personally think that this is a very exciting topic in itself. And starting idea is like almost trivial, right? So we take our complicated metric space, like hyperbolic space, like on this picture, or anything else that you like, and then say, okay, like general metrics are hard, let's approximate them with something. So there are like two answers what you might want to approximate it with. One approximation that is good in many cases is by some norm space. So for example, it's natural to try to embed metric space into, say, Euclidean space or like L1 space or something like this. But often, if you especially want to solve some combinatorial problem on your metric, a reasonable notion of approximation is just trying to approximate your metric with a tree. Trees are easy, right? So you may want to run all kinds of algorithms on the tree, like some dynamic programming or some kind of like bottom-up recursion or top-down or whatever. Like trees are easy. Like general metrics are hard. But of course, this is like hopeless problem, right? In general, because suppose that your tree, your metric is just like take a cycle of length n. This is a simple graph, and consider shortest path metric of it. Then there is no way to approximate it with a tree. You will need to cut it somewhere, and if you cut it somewhere, you immediately blow up distances by a factor of capital N, right? And okay, this is not a proof of the lower bound, but lower bound is actually known for the case of cycle. So cycles are bad for like deterministic approximation with the trees. And of course, the solution is to randomize, right? Say we take our cycle, but instead of cutting it somewhere in a predetermined place, we cut it in a random place. And then if you cut it in a random place, then for every fixed pair of points, you can see that distances blow up by a factor at most 2 on average. And this simple example can be generalized very prominently. Of course, such a result for general metric spaces is much more complicated. And historically, the first result, but quantitatively suboptimal, was obtained by Bartal in 96. And then there were a bunch of improvements, culminating into two independent papers by Fakhchurian, Fall, Rao, and Talwar, and Gupta, Kraut, Gamer, and Lee, who both obtained optimal bounds for this problem. So they were basically able to show that any endpoint metric probabilistically can be approximated by a tree up to a factor log n. And this log n is sharp. So this is like beautiful line of theoretical work that I always admired and I still admire. I think it's like, it's really like gems of theoretical computer science. It's really, really beautiful ideas and really influential. However, I never considered these results practical in any way. First of all, because of this log n factors. And second, if you know specific algorithms, how this is done, they do not scream as like practical to me. It doesn't mean that they are not, but that was my impression at least. So at the same time, this is what's happening for general metrics. But at the same time, in many scenarios, you may want to work not with general metrics, but with something at least a little bit more restricted. So instead of general metrics, let's consider, let's say that our metric originates from a d-dimensional space equipped with, for example, L1 or L2 distance, or someone took our metric and embedded it nicely into these spaces. So one way or another, instead of working with general metrics, we work with subsets of Euclidean or L1 space. So can we then approximate our metric easier with a tree? And turns out the answer is yes, and this is precisely this QuadTree algorithm that was defined and first analyzed by Indyk and Tupper. And again, let me emphasize that QuadTrees in computational geometry, they are known from 60s and 70s, but they're usually used for some other problems, not for approximations with trees. And moreover, usually in those applications, QuadTrees do not scale well to high-dimensional problems. So they impose some exponential dependencies on the dimension or something like this. But here, I'm presenting you a way to use a QuadTree in a way that actually works very well for high dimensions, both in terms of algorithmic efficiency and accuracy. So we'll see what this means in a second. But so suppose we now have n points, how do we want to approximate them with a tree? So let's say that we have these 3 points. What do we do? First of all, the idea is to impose a box of sufficiently large side so that it covers all the points. And then we will be building gradually our tree. So initially, tree consists of just the root node, right? So then we start like partitioning this box into boxes which are half the size of the large box. And then we start recursing. And we stop our recursion as soon as in a given node, we have only 1 point. So for example, red node already got isolated, so we just stop there. But in the second node, we continue recursing, right? So we partition like this. And again, yellow and blue node are not isolated, so we continue partitioning. At the end of the day, we succeed. And this is our tree that we were able to obtain. So there are a few things to say here. First of all, what does it mean to partition? So if you partition your cube into cubes of half the size, you will get 2 to D of them. And 2 to D is terrible. We don't want to have exponential dependence on the dimension because we might want to run something in 100 dimensions or something like this. But we don't need all of these cubes. We just need non-empty cubes. And non-empty cubes, there can be only so many of them, right? Another thing I would like to say is that how we put weights on the tree, right? So if, like, basically I'm putting weight on an edge, which is basically side of the cube, like side length of the cube that corresponds to this node, right? So for example, for this red point, the cube was of size delta over 2, so we just put delta over 2 here. And this is our metric approximation. This is our tree approximation of our metric defined on these points. So, okay, so I lied to you a little bit in the following way. If you just run this algorithm literally, of course it will be terrible, because what can happen is that there can be 2 very close points and they can be cut at a very high level, right? And then tree distance between them will be terrible and totally not representative of how close they actually are. But again, the solution, as with the cycle, is to randomize. But here we randomize by basically before starting our partition, let's just, when imposing this first large cube, let's just like shift it at random. So wiggle it a little bit and kind of start it in a random place. Again, I'm being slightly hand wavy here, but it's very easy to formalize what this means. And basically, if you impose this randomly shifted grid, then actually like you can get very nice guarantees and the following kind. So in the original Indyk and Tupper paper, in fact, they used QuadTree just for low dimensions. But then in this paper of Andoni, Indyk, and Krautgammer, they analyzed algorithm that, which is very similar to QuadTree, but you can show that the analysis goes through also for QuadTree. And it obtains the following bounds. So the bounds are the following. So say you have 2 fixed points from our metric, for example, this red and blue one, right? So then we can look what's the distance in the tree metric and what's the L1 distance in the original space. And then I claim that in the tree, on average, I blow up my distance by at most logarithmic factor and logarithmic in the dimension and basically this like aspect ratio. So here I implicitly assume that minimum distance between points is at least 1. So then this delta would be kind of like both diameter and aspect ratio of our data set at the same time. At the same time, my distances do not become too small. So basically probability, only with very small probability, my distances contract. So basically, if I don't want them to contract by a factor more than log 1 over delta, I can guarantee that with probability at least 1 minus delta. So just with probability delta, there would be such a contraction. So few things to say here. First of all, as you can see, dependence on dimension is perfect. It's just logarithmic. It's not like exponential or polynomial in the approximation, like what you might be afraid to get. Another thing to say here is that this works for L1 distance, but in order for this, so almost the same thing works for L2 distance. Basically, L2 distance can be made L1 if you do a random rotation. So this is like classic result of from functional analysis from like 70s or 80s. There are like, again, many results like this. But basically, if you want to do the same for Euclidean distance, just do a random rotation, impose a quad tree, and then you would get very similar guarantees. Yeah, I think that might be all I want to say about quad trees, at least for now. Let's see how to use them for Earth mover distance. So remember that we started with our intuition that EMD on the tree is easy. And I told you, okay, I lied to you a little bit, we will have some special trees. Okay, now it's time to explain what I meant by special trees. By special trees, I meant something that is called hierarchically separated trees. It's basically a trees where edge weights decrease exponentially as you go from the root to the leaf, right? So for example, our quad tree is hierarchically separated tree, right? Because our weights divide by 2 as we descend down the tree. And in fact, like all these results that approximate metrics with trees, they also like, as a byproduct, they also approximate them with hierarchically separated tree. And why hierarchically separated trees are nice? Because then it's easy to see that you can compute optimal integral or fractional matching as you please, just using very simple bottom-up greedy algorithm. So you basically need to go from leaves to root and kind of mesh things greedily as we go. So for example, in this picture, if I want to match red and blue points, I obviously should match these 2 points first. And then I match these 2 points. So basically, because weights are exponentially decreasing, it's easy to see that this greedy gives optimal solution. But this is not the end of the story, because not only I promised you an easy algorithm for EMD over the trees, I also told you that actually EMD over the trees is just L1 distance in disguise. And why is this the case? Well, let's again do this example. So let's construct the following vectors. So basically coordinates of these vectors would be just 3 nodes, and values of the coordinates would be defined as follows. So for example, for 2 red points, we just take both of these points and consider paths from the leaves to the roots, and we just put respective weights multiplied by, like, okay, so for example, okay, let me be more specific. So for example, to this point, I put delta over 4 because I just have 1 point here. To this point, I put delta over 2 because it's like next level, so it's delta over 2. But again, there is only 1 red point in the subtree. So here I also put delta over 2 for the same reason. But here I put 2 delta instead of delta because now I have 2 points in the subtree, right? So I have 2 times respective weight, which is delta. And then I do the same for blue nodes. So here I have put 2 delta. Here I put delta because I have still 2 points in the subtree. And I put delta over 4 and delta over 4 in each of these leaves. And now if you think what L1 distance between this vector does, it essentially emulates this bottom-up greedy. So for example, roots will cancel out. Then basically leaves contribute like 3 delta over 4. This corresponds to matching these 2 nodes plus like pushing up this other blue node. And, okay, in any case, you can easily check that such a general construction will give like L1 distance between these vectors corresponds exactly to Earth mover distance between points in the original hierarchically separated tree. And this is it. This is how we solve Earth mover distance using quad tree. So basically, we just build a quad tree, and then we obtain this quad tree to embed our distributions into L1. And then we just say that up to a log. So by the way, let's see what guarantees we get. So here, the starting point is just guarantees from the previous slide what QuadTree means for tree distances and what it implies for Earth mover distance. So basically, here I impose some assumption that support of my distributions is of size at most S. And then effectively speaking, what I'm getting is polylogarithmic approximation for Earth mover distance. So basically I'm getting approximation that depends on dimension logarithmically and on this support size. And this is not hard to show. I'm not going to do it because I don't have time for this. But in principle, it pretty easily follows from these two inequalities that we presented on the previous page for just like how tree distances are related to L1 distances. Here, let me just say that I'm using support size bound in order to claim that with high probability, tree distances between all pairs in the support would not be contracted too much. So we need this like for all property because EMD is an optimization problem. But again, these are details. This is not too important. So basically this like logarithmic quality of this quad tree translates into logarithmic quality for this EMD distance. And let me also say one thing that if we just want to solve a single instance of EMD, this is it. But remember that we wanted to solve nearest neighbors with respect to EMD. So we need to compute n distances at the same time. And then quality deteriorates a little bit because we need to take union bound not over all pairs of points in the support, but also overall points in our data set. So this imposes additional factor of n in the approximation here.
If it's okay for me to ask a stupid question at this point.
Sure.
It looks, QuadTree is used for nearest neighbor calculations, I guess, maybe most classically. Is that correct?
It is correct, yeah. But that's precisely an example which doesn't scale with the dimension going to infinity.
Yeah, so, yeah. So, I mean, would there be a benefit to do like locality sensitive hashing or something like that to speed up this calculation even more?
Of course. So because you embed it into L1, in L1 you can do whatever you want, right? And in L1 there are all kinds of things like locality sensitive hashing. We will get to it. But okay. Yeah, definitely there is benefit. Yeah. So I'm just giving you a black box reduction to some problem that is well studied, and there you can use whatever you want. Whatever you want. Even if you just use linear scan with L1 is much, much, much better than linear scan with EMD. That's already the improvement.
Yep. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Awesome. So finally, okay, towards the end of the talk, it's time to talk about our results a little bit. So basically, okay, so what is FlowTree? FlowTree is a very simple hack over QuadTree. I'm not fully sure why people never considered it before, but the hack is like almost trivial, but it kind of like gives a very, very big improvements in what we've seen, and we will see it. So basically the idea is let's find the optimal matching as before. But before, when we found this matching, we said, okay, let's just see what's the cost of this matching in the tree metric. But now I don't want this anymore. Why do I want to lose? Like, so sure, finding matching is hard, and this tree embedding really benefited me. So I can at least find this matching using greedy algorithm easily. But now in order to compute my estimate, let me compute cost of this integral of fractional matching with respect to original metric on my space, right? So for example, if we have L1 distance or L2 distance, let's just compute this functional, pretty much just using this greedy matching that we found only as a matching, not its cost. Its cost we basically extract from the original metric. So that's the whole improvement. Okay? So it's really, really, really simple, almost naive. So first of all, let's start with drawbacks of this. So drawback is that it's not an embedding into L1 anymore. And maybe that's why people didn't really look at it, because people were mostly occupied with like, you know, embeddability of Wasserstein spaces. And they kind of said, okay, like QuadTree gives something nice. But in this talk, as Mark asked correctly, pointed out correctly, I would say, embedding into nice spaces is beneficial because then we can use algorithmic techniques we developed for these spaces. But if you just care about fast algorithms, okay, maybe like not being able to embed is okay, because like finding greedy matching is still sufficiently fast and then like computing cost with respect to original metric is sufficiently fast, so let's just use it. And that's exactly the whole idea of this paper, pretty much. So let's see how this is beneficial in the remaining 10 minutes. Let me try to tell you why this is beneficial from theory and empirical standpoint. So let's start with theoretical guarantees. So these are the approximations that we were able to obtain for QuadTree, right? So basically we get this log D log S approximation if we just compute one EMD instance. And if we have n of them, so we lose this additional n, or rather log n in this approximation. So the first improvement, it's again almost trivial, but it's actually nice to see that actually we don't like for FlowTree, we are not losing this additional factor of n within the log. And again, the rough reason why this is so is because FlowTree never underestimates. So basically because it always finds some valid matching and computes its true cost, the only thing it can do, it can compute matching that is suboptimal, right? So estimate that FlowTree gives us, it's never less than the true EMD cost. And this has a nice implications for nearest neighbor search, because imagine that you have a query and you have n data points. And like, when do we succeed? We succeed when close points will not be overestimated and far points will not be underestimated. But for far points, we have this property automatically, so we don't need to take certain union bound. Again, like if you don't understand what the hell I'm talking about, this is perfectly fine. But basically because FlowTree does not underestimate, basically we get for free the same approximation as QuadTree gets for a single EMD computation. But in fact, we can get a little bit further and obtain a certain dimension-free estimate, at least for the case when your matching is integral. It's in fact a little bit more general than that, but like, let me just say that it doesn't apply in like absolutely full generality. And this is pretty neat, I think, because it shows that actually like dimension is completely irrelevant for approximating Earth-mover distance, which I think is a very interesting statement in itself. And of course, these are polylog bounds are nice, but at the end of the day, they're still too pessimistic in practice, right? And in practice, we might want to, or rather like in order to better understand what works or doesn't work well in practice, we have certain beyond worst case analysis results in the paper. I'm not going to talk about them here, but let me just say that we consider certain stochastic model that we kind of argue that represents real data a little bit better than the worst case and show like in what sense FlowTree is better than QuadTree for that setting as well. So this is pretty much it for theoretical guarantees. Let me spend the remaining 7 minutes talking about empirical results. First of all, we have all these algorithms and baselines implemented. Basically, we implemented them in C++ with a Python wrapper. And like we think that our implementation are like very, very polished and fast. They're published on GitHub. I will show a link in the end. For some of the baselines that require this like matrix operations, such as synchron iterations, we use basically like very fast linear algebra libraries, such as OpenBLAS, properly linked to NumPy. Again, if you don't understand what any of these words mean, this is like, again, perfectly okay. But basically like the takeaway is that we tried hard to make all algorithms like as competitive as possible. Basically numbers that I will show you, they correspond to a single CPU core. Of course, a whole separate topic becomes like, how can we use GPUs or specialized hardware for problems like this? But for the sake of this talk, let's just focus like on a very, on like probably the simplest setting, like single core of a CPU. So what's the task that we are gonna try to solve? So pretty much it's basically this like image or text retrieval task that I told you in the beginning about. So I have bunch of texts or bunch of images, and they're represented as some distributions. For example, for texts, we take word embeddings computed by this algorithm called GloVe, and represent each text as uniform distribution over respective word embeddings. And then I would like to retrieve k most similar distributions or documents with respect to Earth mover distance, right? So again, for simplicity, we focus on the case k equals one. I don't think results change for larger k. This is just like easier to explain what's going on for k equals one. And how can we compare algorithms? So if you like, okay, so the first naive attempt, let's just run all the algorithms and see how fast they are. But then the problem with this approach is that, of course, like many algorithms are incomparable, right? Because there are like cheap but crude algorithms. There are like slow but like fine algorithms. So there is a whole spectrum, right? So there is a trade-off between accuracy and efficiency. And it's interesting to see how individual algorithms perform to kind of like establish some taxonomy of them. So what is fast, what is slow, what is accurate, what is not. But at the end of the day, in order to have like final competition, the right thing to do is to consider pipelines of algorithms. So what is a pipeline in this context? So it's how people actually search for nearest neighbors in practice. So instead of using one algorithm, we kind of like pipeline several algorithms one after another. And we kind of first put usually some kind of like cheap crude algorithm, like that kills almost all irrelevant points, yet it's like super fast to run, and we run it just on the whole data set. So we feed data set into it and basically use this algorithm to filter like K1 candidates. And then algorithm two further narrows down this list to K2 candidates. And then maybe in the end, we just run like exact computation on these few selected candidates and obtain maybe one single point that may or may not be nearest neighbor, true nearest neighbor, depending whether some previous stages cut the true nearest neighbor out, right? So this is the proper evaluation, and this is how nearest neighbors are often searched. And again, like following up on like Mark's suggestion, you can use things like LSH as a first stage, right? So you can use some kind of locality sensitive hashing as a way to filter out like maybe some list of candidates of points, but then usually you want to inspect this list using some further slower and slower, but more and more accurate algorithms, like culminating in like exact algorithm maybe.
Yeah, so just to, so that I understand a little bit better. So you're gonna be doing a nearest neighbor search here. I guess this is gonna be earth mover distance for Euclidean comparisons of the feature vectors associated with the bag of words model sort of.
Right, for like two of our three data sets, yes. On another data set, we will be doing a little bit, you'll see, but yes, this is definitely for two out of three experiments, we're doing exactly what you said, yeah.
Okay, great.
So actually, let me talk now about data sets and what we are doing. So basically, we have two text data sets, and again, they're just 10,000 texts. This is like nothing, right? This is not a big data or anything like this, right? This is just like a tiny data set that people traditionally used for these kinds of algorithmic tasks, and that's where we do what I told what Mark just told us, right? So we basically consider word embeddings and our underlying metric is just Euclidean distance between these word embeddings, and then we consider earth mover distance on top of that. So this is our measure here, and the third data set is like images. Again, I'm not fully convinced that this is a good image retrieval task, but this we mostly did to be directly comparable with previous papers, because this is something that many optimal transport papers do. I'm not fully sold on meaningfulness of this task, but you know, it's not completely bogus either. So let's just look at it. So MNIST is like standard data set of digits. So we can interpret each digit as a distribution over like Euclidean plane pretty much. So here underlying metric is also Euclidean, but it's low dimensional. It's just like two dimensional, right? And again, we can ask the retrieval problem and, you know, see how fast can we do it. So what are the algorithms that we evaluate? Maybe I will go over time just by a few minutes. I don't have too much stuff left, so let me just.
That's fine. We're here as long as you are.
Sure. Okay. I promise I won't be too long. So algorithms naturally divide into three groups. So the first group of algorithms is what I would call fast linear time algorithms. So these are the algorithms that are especially fast. This is like mean, QuadTree. And then also there are these like algorithms overlap and TF-IDF. Actually, there is a typo, but never mind. Let me not talk about overlap and TF-IDF because they're not going to be good anyways. But the point of these fast linear time algorithms is that they essentially compute embedding of AMD into some kind of vectors, L1 and L2. And then at the end of the day, in order to estimate AMD distance, we just compute like L1 distance between vectors or L2 distance between vectors. This is like ultra fast. So then there is what I call slow linear time algorithm, and that's exactly where our flow tree falls into. So on one hand, it's still linear time, you know, like there is no cheating here, but because like matching, finding greedy matching is very easy, it's linear time. But at the same time, it's not as nice as say computing distance between means because it's not as cache friendly, it's not vectorizable, and so on. So basically, it will be noticeably slower than fast linear time algorithms. At the same time, many of the algorithms that were used in prior work, they essentially at least require writing down the cost matrix. So I told you about these algorithms in the beginning as like non-metric case, right? When we need to first write like the full cost matrix and then do something about it, like matrix scaling or some greedy or something like this, right? So they're noticeably slower. They at least require time quadratic in the support size. Yeah. So let's look at the individual algorithms. First, let's look at the running times. Let's not even bother with qualities for now. So basically, running times empirically confirm what I told you about division into three groups. So there is mean, which is like ultra fast. There is TF-IDF and these other fast algorithms that are also super fast. Then there is QuadTree that is noticeably slower than these guys. But at the same time, it's much faster than these non-metric algorithms. And all of these non-metric algorithms are so much faster than exact EMD computation that exact EMD computation is like barely an option, I would say. It is a good algorithm just, you know, for like sanity check that we compute everything correctly and so on and so forth. But like 154 seconds and that's just like per single query. It's basically to compute EMD distance between single query and all MNIST takes like 154 seconds on average. This is just insane. Okay, but running times are meaningless, right? If we don't talk about quality. So the next slides, I'm going to spend talking about quality. So let's just take one data set, 20 news. On all the other data sets, the picture is similar. And let's look at what's going on quality-wise. So first of all, what the hell are these plots? So basically here, I'm doing the following experiment. I'm running my algorithm of choice, like mean or flow tree or whatever, and compute n estimates of my EMD distances between query and each data point. And then I choose some number of candidates that is specified on the x-axis. And then I'm asking, what's the fraction of queries on which this set of candidates contains true nearest neighbor? So basically, to the left is better, higher is better. And then there is a sharp division of algorithms into two groups. Basically, fast algorithms, they produce pretty crappy trade-offs. So basically, mean, TF-IDF, overlap, and QuadTree is a little bit better, but still like not so great. But all the remaining algorithms, like starting from FlowTree and to Singhorn, they're like so good that on this plot, you can't even tell them apart. So that's why I put them on a separate plot on the right. And as you can see, FlowTree is not the best, but it's not the worst either. So for example, it's faster than greedy algorithm, which is actually, sorry, it's faster than all of them, but it's higher quality also than greedy algorithm and on par with this greedy plus plus. And it's a little bit worse than Singhorn algorithm. And basically the same picture holds for other data sets. I'm not going to spend much time on it, but the takeaway here is that FlowTree, it's much faster than these non-metric algorithms. And at the same time, it has quality comparable to them. Here also like on MNIST actually QuadTree works also especially well, maybe because it's like low dimensional. I don't have a good explanation for this. But let's talk a little bit about pipelines. So let's do a fair comparison, you know, like how we would use these algorithms in reality, right? So just a reminder, what is a pipeline? So this is like we compose several algorithms culminating with maybe exact algorithm. And we basically narrow down as data, our data set as we go. And of course, this requires us to understand which algorithms to use and how to tune these parameters K1 and K2. And the objective function that we choose here is running time, but under what constraints? So basically we want that the resulting, so we want to return 1 of 5 points. Why I'm asking 1 of 5, it will be clear later. Let's just think of 1 point for a second. I want to return 1 point and I want it to be nearest neighbor with probability 0.9. So basically by probability, I mean over queries. So on 90% of the queries, I guess the correct point. And we just ran it only on one data set because it's like very time consuming to tune all these pipelines, but I'm sure results generalize to other data sets. And so this is a punchline. Basically, introducing FlowTree to pipelines allows to speed them up by a lot. So in one case, it's like almost factor of 10 when we return 5 points and we wanted to contain nearest neighbor correctly. In another case, it's something like 6. No, not 6. Okay, I can't count, like 3.5, something like this. So basically, introducing FlowTree Basically, FlowTree works well in synergy with other algorithms. So basically, it makes any pipeline better, pretty much. So if you have some pipeline for retrieval with respect to Earth moon distance, just add FlowTree to it, and it will work better. But okay, so slightly more specifically. So template for pipelines was the following. So we first start with very fast algorithm, mean QuadTree or overlap again, never mind what it is. Then we possibly have FlowTree. Then we possibly have non-metric algorithm, which is like slower and requires writing down full cost matrix. And then we have exact algorithm, again, possibly. So basically, we concluded that QuadTree is unconditionally the best algorithm to use as a starting point. So it's better than mean and overlap. It's slower than mean, but it narrows down data set so much better that mean is not worth it, as we found out. FlowTree always improves things. So again, like as I said, if you have a pipeline, just add FlowTree to it and it will be better. And the exact algorithm, funnily enough, it's not always necessary. For example, if you are okay with just returning 5 points, hoping that it contains your, it hits your nearest neighbor, then like exact sometimes is not necessary. And to just like visualize this, I prepared this, actually in the paper, we have these plots. So basically these are the pipelines and breakdown in the pipeline between the components. So basically this gray area is like how much time exact computations take. Then this like yellow is how much time QuadTree takes. This orange is FlowTree, and all these other bars are for like other algorithms. And the point is here, if we introduce FlowTree at a small cost, it allows us to compress further components of the pipeline by a lot. Like for example, if I add FlowTree here, I don't need to run Synchorn for that many candidates. By the way, I should also say that Synchorn 1 and Synchorn 3, I forgot to tell you, I should have told you, this just means run Synchorn iterations for one iteration and for three iterations. Here we run only for very few iterations because running time here is somehow is very important. So key takeaway here is that overall, even like not regarding FlowTree, is that unlike Euclidean KNNS, nearest neighbor search with respect to Earth mover distance exhibits a much diverse efficiency accuracy trade-off. So there are like many more algorithms that are incomparable with each other. And that's why these pipelines consisting of like bunch of algorithms are actually meaningful. So for example, what's the best pipeline? So the best pipeline is to run QuadTree, sorry, then FlowTree, then Synchorn for three iterations, and then bunch of exact computations, right? And this turns out to be like dominating all the other things that we've tried and that we actually tried pretty exhaustively. Another interesting difference between Euclidean nearest neighbor search, because in Euclidean nearest neighbor search, computing distances is so cheap, you can actually afford to compute quite a few of them. Here, like exact distance computations are so expensive that we really, really, really don't want to do more than maybe like three of them or five of them or like two of them, because otherwise they would dominate the overall running time and it would be very slow. So I think it's an interesting setup where actually like approximating distances ends up being a much bigger necessity than for the Euclidean case. Okay. Let me actually conclude my talk finally to not hold you much longer. So what we've done in this talk is introduced a FlowTree, which is a simple modification to the classic QuadTree for estimating the AMD distance, which works great in high dimensions. And it yields better theoretical and especially empirical results. Implementation, which is like C++ with Python wrapper, is available in this GitHub repo. And we actually spent quite a bit of effort so that it runs seamlessly in a number of operating systems. So I hope that the quality of our releases is slightly at least better than the usual research code release. But again, like if you want to try to run it and something doesn't work, just feel free to email me or leave a pull request on GitHub or anything that you like. Okay, I think that's it for this talk. Now, if you have any questions, it's a good time to ask them.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I'll open up the floor to the other panelists and anyone else who wants to ask a question through the Q&A. And maybe the questions build up here. Something, my own stupid question. Is it true that this mean method is the fastest since it's sort of reducing the distribution to a mean?
Right. It is fastest. Yeah, it is very, very fast, not only because it reduces to a single point, but just also because computing Euclidean distances, basically it uses like SIMD vector instructions in the CPU, and it's just so fast that it's like unimaginable how fast it is. Yet it is not so great, and that's why we actually found that it was promising. We were hoping that we can use mean as a starting point, but we found that QuadTree, even though it's like noticeably slower, it's actually very, it's more meaningful. And why this is noticeably slower, by the way, I should also note, because it actually computes L1 distance, but not between dense vectors, it computes L1 distance between sparse vectors. Because we have this like big tree that we build from all word embeddings, and then when we receive a distribution, it's just a small subtree in this tree. So basically our vectors between which we want to compute L1 distance, they're very sparse.
So this is probably a dumb question, but what if instead of just reducing the distribution to its mean, why not include the variance in other moments and sort of reduce it to a vector of moments and then run a regular sort of, use whatever distance you want on the moment vectors and
we haven't tried it. It could be a reasonable suggestion. Actually, I think actually it's a nice suggestion. Yeah,
it'd also be fast, right? But
it definitely makes sense. I mean, again, I would be a little bit worried. For example, imagine mnist, right? So for mnist digits, they have very similar means, and that's why mean is terrible on mnist. But also they have kind of similar variances, right? Because they're kind of inscribed in the same square, right? So I would not expect at least like just consider like just adding variance, for example, would improve things by a lot. But you know, like maybe higher moments would make sense. It's a great suggestion. Yeah, we haven't tried it.
Okay, so I was just wondering. Other panelists want to answer any of these Q&A questions, or should I start doing it?